The Sonata Funèbre, Opus 35 by Frédéric Chopin. The dramatic four-bar opening gesture of the first movement is clearly marked grave, serving to indicate both the solemnity of Chopin's tempo and mood. These measures also govern the artistic and thematic destiny of the whole composition. It is essential to observe the subsequent marking, given by Chopin, of doppio movimento, if the structure and artistic balance of the whole is to be preserved and expressed integrally as the composer intended. Chopin means exactly what he says with regard to this precise tempo relationship. It has been suggested that his grave tempo indication pertains only to the mood and does not necessarily affirm the extremely slow tempo that our metronomes would have us believe. Well, how then do we double the speed, doppio movimento, of a mood? Further, tempo markings are always placed at the head of the stave and notation, and, as in Chopin, in larger letters than the marks of expression. He also knew very well how to indicate faster tempi, and would have chosen different terminology had he wanted it. I have actually read, more than once, that Chopin gave no tempo for this movement, which is astonishing. I politely suggest that perhaps these people purchase a metronome showing that this tempo is even slower than largo. Largo is the slowest tempo on the more readily available metronome. It is also worth mentioning that it is common knowledge that Chopin's metronome never left his piano. Here are the opening grave measures into the doppio movimento. The first subject motive is basically constructed on a series of alternating two- and three-note fragmented phrases, or slurs, each interspersed with silences, notated as rests. I shall now illustrate just the right hand for the entry of this motive. The entry of this subject motive is marked agitato, but piano. It is therefore important to guard against the obliteration of these rests with excessive pedalling. This theme is extensively developed and intensified on repetition throughout the movement. Subsequently, in the development section, Chopin builds a tripartite layering for his treatment of the first subject. First, we have the fortissimo and accented grave motives, now in doppio movimento, low bass, to this is added the upper bass triplets, which are a rhythmic feature of this movement. Now, the treble register, harmonized first subject, as a grandiose presentation. That wonderful section is rarely taken any faster, irrespective of artistic considerations, due to the extreme technical difficulties already involved. It is noticeable that the easier option to dash off the first entry of this subject rarely corresponds in tempo to the section just played. In view of the importance of the interrelation between corresponding sections and the organic whole as a concise formal structure, it is extremely damaging at all levels to resort to any of the steamroller approaches. So, hold on to your hats. Horrors. An amorphous mass of sound. How far removed from Chopin that is. I cannot stress enough that a tempo has to be secured, against which all marked rhythms and tempo markings can be centered. A central axis for the fundamental pulse to be secured against. Those illustrations conclude the main first theme presentations and show something of their important interrelationship. I now turn to the consolatory and lyrical second subject theme. This serves to resolve the tensions of the predominating first subject. These measures also undergo various transformations. An example of this is where the theme is accompanied by the triplets that are one of the many rhythmic features of this extraordinary movement. Therefore, the same triplet rhythms elsewhere in this movement should be no faster than and not at the end of the exposition, the tempo is pushed by Chopin with the stretto marking at bar 93, often usually taken several bars earlier. This stretto ends at the sustained fortissimo chords, which lead us back to the opening grave. These bars form an intrinsic part of the whole and are to be repeated. They are also a good checking point with regard to tempo. Correspondingly, at the end of the recapitulation, the stretto should begin at bar 231, but I have had the misfortune to hear an interpretation where this stretto appeared to be indicated from the very first note of the sonata and continued, reaching this sort of unholy pitch. Unforgivable, but sadly a common interpretation. Dare I say that I have witnessed this approach at the Royal Festival Hall, and well received it was too. Before I move on to the scherzo second movement, I will play from the stretto given in this movement at bar 231 to the end of bar 242. The first subject motive on this occasion appears in octaves in the low bass register, soon to be modified as the final B-flat minor chords acclaim the end of the movement.